Stop talking politics. Okay, so we'll adjourn the meeting. I apologize, my voice is a little bit lower than usual. So if you can't hear me, just let me know and I'll try to project better. It's still kind of a COVID voice, so working on that. Okay, so roll call. Barry Miller.
I'm here.
Is here. Liz Rosen is here. Howard Kagan is not here yet. We expect him. Jeff Collins is here. Linda Lover has excused absence. Caroline Jerome has an excused absence. Dorothea Marcus is here. Leslie Gerber is here. It looks like he's here. Trying to get his audio working. We can hear you. We can hear you, Leslie.
I just want to make it louder.
We can hear you. We can see you. You look like you're okay.
Press that green little thing. Is it louder?
Maybe you can't hear us. Marcia Patton's here. Kevin Kraft is here. And Ros Belkin is here. So we have quorum. And we have two people who couldn't make it. Okay, so motion to adopt the agenda. Is there a second to the motion to adopt the agenda?
I'll second it.
Okay, motion made by Jeff Collins, seconded by Barry Miller. Yeah, any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, motion to adopt the consent agenda. The consent agenda consists of motion to approve the minutes of the July 21st, 2022 board meeting, to approve the corrected date of the public vote on the 2023 budget and trustee election to be Thursday, October 6, 2022, to approve the vouchers for the operating funds, item 28884 through 28929, and the capital fund, bond 1 through bond 9. To approve the payment of invoice number 585945 from Whitman, Oosterman, and Hanna in the amount of $15,517.64 for services rendered through July 31st, 2022, regarding the lawsuit brought by the Library Lovers of Woodstock, New York. See attached invoice. Motion to appoint Risa Palmer Silic. Tell me if that's close.
I think so.
A part-time clerk at $15 an hour, and the motion to approve changes recommended by the policy committee to petty cash policy and the unattended children policy. I would like to remove the item 4 from the consent agenda. I'd like to have a discussion about it. Any board member want to remove any other items from the consent agenda? I do not see that, so make a motion to adopt the consent agenda minus item 4. Is there a second for that?
I'll second it.
Barry Miller seconded it. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, I wanted to discuss item 4, which is to approve payment of invoice 585945. My purpose of discussion is to point out to the public how much this lawsuit is costing the taxpayers. It's already $15,500. This is just the first invoice from them. We have a hearing, I believe, in September. I don't have an exact date for that, but it's projected to be September. That hearing will incur significant other costs to the taxpayers. So we've already spent $1,517 on this lawsuit. Any other discussion on this?
15,000, not 15,000.
15,000, thank you. 15,517.64.
I have a question, Jeff. People are always asking me this, and I'm not sure I have a clear answer. They want to know if the case is dismissed or, is decided in our favor. Is there the possibility for having the other side paying our legal fees, as happens in civil cases?
I believe that's not possible on this kind of a lawsuit. I believe in Section 78, the municipality is cannot go after the litigants, I think that's the right term, to recover costs.
Yeah, I think you're probably right, but I didn't know if that was definite. Thank you.
Yeah.
I'm getting a lot of the same inquiries, Dorothea and Jeff. So it is, I don't know if there's a statement to be made or something to let people know exactly what the facts are regarding that.
Well, what I was planning to do was after this board meeting, since we're going to have a finalized budget and we have the trustee and budget election coming up, I was going to do a notes to the community. So I could put it in there.
Let me check and make sure. I'll send a quick email to the lawyer to make sure that that's the case, that we can recover costs because we're a municipality.
Yeah, I mean, Article 78 is, you know, its own animal, so.
It is, yeah.
Yeah. But I mean, we could just make a statement. I mean, just a factual statement of that.
I just want to make sure it's a factual one.
That's exactly.
I want to make sure it's factual.
Great. Yeah. Thank you.
Yep. Any other discussion on this?
Have we asked our lawyers if there's any possibility of counseling these people for damages?
We're just discussing that. We feel like we believe that because it's a Section 78 that we cannot sue them for damages.
Shit.
And again, I will check that with our lawyer just to verify that.
I'm profoundly sorry to hear that.
Yeah, I guess it would be two separate things. One is recovering legal fees, and the other would be a counter lawsuit for harassment, or, you know, it seems like those would be two different things.
Well, I'd be in favor of both of them.
I'll check with the lawyer on both of those.
Okay.
Questions. Okay.
Thank you.
Any other discussion on this item? Okay, so I'll make a motion to approve the payments of invoice 585945 from Whiteman, Osterman, and Hanna in the amount of $15,517.64 for services rendered through July 31st, 2022, regarding the lawsuit brought by Library Lovers of Woodstock, New York.
I'll second it.
Seconded by Barry Miller. Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, approved. Okay, moving to the director's report, Ivy.
Here I am. The big news is that we're down to staff members kind of suddenly. So we're scrambling a little bit to fill those positions, but as you guys just approved, we have hired Risa Palmer-Selig as a part-time clerk. They are working at the Millbrook Library also, so we only get them for 12 hours a week. But the great thing about them working at that library is they already know everything they need to know about how the Mid-Hudson system works. So it's been a pretty easy on-ramp for them so far. And then I just made a note that we do have three entirely new staff members in just the past 3 months. So if you haven't actually been into the library lately, take some time to meet them. They're all very friendly. Amy, Ian, and Risa.
Just to be clear, Risa's pronoun is they?
Yes, that's right. That's right.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. We will be moving to a new online calendar pretty soon that will, it will launch with the new website, which we've been, that project has been revived, thankfully. So the cool thing about this new calendar tool is that when we're in 10 Dixon and we have those rooms that are reservable by members of the public, this calendar tool has a room reservation module. So it's already built in that we'll be able to book rooms for people. And it also, it ties into the calendar so that you don't accidentally double book an event in a room that's going to be used by a different group. So we're excited to get that going. We have trainings on that for staff next week.
Ivy, who is JR?
JR. Oh, JR. He works with Caroline. He's working on our website development.
Oh, okay.
JR Harvey.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah. I assumed everybody knew him, but I guess not.
Okay. Wasn't JR in Dallas?
Yeah. Who shot him?
I thought you were too young for that, Ivy.
I know, that's what I thought.
I know, that's all I know about Dallas is that someone shot JR. And then other than that, we're sort of wrapping up summer reading programming and getting stuff ready for the fall. We have a bunch of stuff ready for climate preparedness week, which is in September, that we're excited about. And then we've been doing a lot of different collecting drives. So we were collecting plastic bags, we're collecting school supplies, we're collecting cans, and people seem to really love that. So we kind of keep introducing new ones as old ones phase out. And so for September and October, it will be a canned food drive. And that's one that other libraries are participating in. So it's a little competitive. We want to beat the other libraries. Not much else to call out here other than I started talking to the folks at Woodstock's Pollinator Pathway Project to see about getting a grant to put in pollinator gardens at both 5 Library Lane and 10 Dixon Avenue. So we have a meeting tomorrow to look at both sites and kind of start to talk about what might be possible. But the Climate Partners of the Hudson Valley is giving out grants for this kind of work. So we're hoping to get one of those that will maybe like thematically tie those two sites together, because I know the pollinator pathway pretty much runs along Tinker Street, as I understand it. So it would be great to get both of those locations included in that effort.
That's brilliant, brilliant.
I'll be happy to donate some Rose of Sharon pups.
Oh, okay.
No, that's an invasive. It's an invasive. You can't use that in a pollinator garden.
But they attract everything, hummingbirds, bees of all varieties. I watch the action all day long.
I'm sorry to interrupt. Yeah, I understand. It usually pollinator gardens though are indigenous plants.
Yeah, well, I'm new to all of this, so I'm hoping to get a quick education so that I can go out and get some of that grant.
I assume experts will be building this, so
yeah. Yes, yeah, yeah, it won't be me personally.
There's a beautiful one at Kenco on Route 28.
Yeah.
In a beautiful little garden to look at.
Oh, okay. And I heard there's one at the Woodstock School of Art that I need to take a look at too. So yeah, we're in good company. And that's about it. I think we have a discussion later about the upcoming trustee election. And so all I had to say finally is that I got the notices into the newspapers just in time. And so I'm working with the staff who's been through this process in past years to make sure we hit our marks on the timeline for that.
I'm kind of bummed I will miss the kangaroos on the 2nd. I won't be in town. I've never met a kangaroo.
Yeah.
So kind of bummed I'm going to miss that opportunity.
We've had a lot of animals this summer. And the kangaroos is of all the animal programs we had, most of them you could touch the animals, but this one you can't. So
they'll feature
you're not
back.
You're not missing an opportunity to punch a kangaroo.
And Holly mentioned the animal programs get the biggest turnout.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Yeah, they're so much fun.
Yeah.
Okay, any questions on the director's report? Okay, we'll move ahead. Financial reports, Liz. You're muted, Liz. Still muted. Liz, you're muted.
Okay, I think I finally unmuted.
Got it. Yep, you're good.
Okay. We've already approved the checks and vouchers. So we can go to the operating budget versus actual. And if you look at the last slide, our total expenses are just about on target for where we are in the year. In the details, we have some things that are over and some things that are under, but we actually only have one item that's over at the moment. But are there any questions on that report?
I have a question. How is the legal bill that we just approved going to affect this?
That is going to put us over. That's going to put us over on professional fees.
Okay.
Yeah, because did we determine that that would need to be paid out of operating and not out of anything else? Okay.
Yeah.
And we can't use the bond money for it?
We certainly can't capitalize it now. I checked with our auditor.
But is bond money only for capital? Or can it be for expenses related to the project?
I think if we can't, since that bond money in a sense is restricted, it was issued for the purpose of buying and renovating 10 Dixon. I don't think we can use it for anything that classifies as operating. And we could check with our lawyers about that.
I would think that's the case. I would believe that's the case.
Yeah.
And why whittle away the bond money on legal fees?
Now Marty has already pleaded not to put bond money in capital because the budget is going to be very tight. So I think we're going to have to put it in operating, which will put us over the budget.
So that shortfall, Liz, that shortfall then has to be accounted for in the budget we're creating now. Is that right?
No, it's going to hit this year's budget.
It will.
We're creating next year's.
Right.
So this will hit this year. We will have a deficit budget this year.
Right. But there's a shortfall then that has to be made up. Is that correct?
We will have, yes, it will and be made will, up out of our fund balance.
In next year's budget though, right? Through next
year? No, it'll be made up out of it'll reduce our fund balance this year.
I see. Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Any other questions on?
There was something all the way up at the beginning, and it says something about a bank, and I was curious what it was. It was on the first page.
On the first page, something about a bank. Under income?
Maybe it wasn't the budget versus actual. It was the first thing that was on the screen before.
I think it was the vouchers.
Checks and vouchers report.
Yeah, Village Bank and Trust. What is that?
That's part of our closing costs.
So what's Village Bank?
That's the wire to buy the building.
And we have to pay taxes. Forgive my ignorance, but I saw that too. And I was just curious. We're not exempt from that real estate transaction.
That is an interesting question. I think we're liable for transfer taxes, but I'm not positive if that's the case.
Yeah, I think we're liable for transfer taxes. If those are real estate taxes that we paid because they had been prepaid by Miller Howard, we should probably apply to get a refund.
It's probably reimbursing them for, I mean, it's an interesting thing. Usually at a closing, you reimburse the seller for taxes they've paid for the balance of the year.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
But, they had, we're reimbursing them for taxes they paid and they're no longer using the building, even though we're not going to be levied taxes for our use of the building.
But we could potentially request a refund.
Potentially, I would think, could get a refund.
Yeah, yeah.
Can you check that out, Liz?
Sure. I'll
talk with our accountant to check that out. Yeah.
A transfer tax is paid by the seller to New York State. That's different than town of Woodstock taxes they would have paid.
So my guess is this is property taxes that they prepaid, given the timing of the transaction. This is probably half of the property taxes that they would have prepaid for the year.
Right.
So we should look at, see if we can get a refund from the school district and the town and the county.
Right. So I think the question is not so much for the accountant, but for the town and the school district.
Okay. Can you follow up on that, Liz, or do you want?
Yeah, I can follow up. I guess I can follow up and find out who to call, who to talk to, and see what we need to do.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah. Property taxes. Okay, if there are no questions about that, we have I didn't see a balance sheet for our operating fund. Oh, there it is. Somehow I didn't get it printed out, but there we are. So our current operating account cash balance is 469,755.61. This includes that $50,000 donation, which on our next meeting, I'm going to make a motion to move that into the Library Improvement Fund, just to prevent us from inadvertently using it, you know, on just kind of to cover operating expenses when we don't mean to use it that way, so that we make a definite decision about what we're doing with that gift.
Was that Neil Smoller's 50?
No, didn't Neil Smoller give us 50,000?
He's giving us equipment, I think, right, Ivy?
I mean, we've just been in talks with him about a makerspace, but there's
technology.
No
technology.
But that's the 50,000 from Barbara Zausner.
Right.
I thought that we already moved that into the Library Improvement Fund.
Yeah, we did, actually. Okay.
I did too. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So we're all right. Yeah. We're right there. And then the capital fund balance sheet, we have, is showing the combined our previous capital fund and the bond fund. Our bookkeepers will break that out so that we'll get two separate reports.
Okay.
So at the moment we have $1,371,000 and at 340 in cash in that account.
I have a question on that account. Is there any interest at all in that account? Even a tiny percentage is useful.
There's a tiny percent of interest in that account, okay. Yes. Yes.
A tiny percent of $1,000,003 is a lot of money.
Yes, it's something you can see as opposed to our operating account where it's under $100.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay. I would like to make a motion, if there are no further questions, to approve the financial reports.
I'll second it.
Okay. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Facilities and planning, Howard isn't here. I can give an update on the building that I know of, or Ivy can do it because Ivy may know this better. I missed the last meeting, so maybe Ivy, you want to do this, or?
Yes. Well, let me see. What did Howard covered pretty much everything. It's pretty exciting. We're able to use most of the furniture that's in there, and it means that we don't have to buy desks or chairs or even like storage really for all of our office spaces. So it's saving us a lot of money, and it makes it easier to deal with everything that's in that building, knowing that we're going to keep it. We are planning to get a couple of storage containers so that we can move all of the furniture out while the building needs to be renovated. So they'll be parked on site, and then we'll move, you know, everything back out of there again. Otherwise, I guess an update is there had been a lot of discussion about the second floor art room and how much the floor needed to be reinforced below it to support the weight up there. But Howard came up with an elegant solution that I can't remember the actual figure. Maybe you do, Jeff, of what the load bearing will be, but it'll be sufficient to have sufficient book collections up there.
Yeah.
Without great having to completely tear apart the structure between those two floors.
Essentially what he's doing, what his plan is to reinforce kind of the middle, like where the hallway is in the first floor, to basically put reinforcement along that hallway, a little bit wider than the hallway. And if done in the way that he's designed it, it'll give us 150 pounds per square foot on, I think, 3/4 of the upstairs. From the west to the east will be 3/4, you know, from the west to the east will be 150 pounds per square foot. The part that will not be, that will be the part that's actually the archive room, which right doesn't need that level of support. So it saves us tearing out the entire first floor ceiling. All we need to do is tear out 2 rows along the first floor ceiling to reinforce it. It should save us a significant amount of money. Also, just talking about saving money, the existing furniture, as Ivy said, most of it can, we're gonna basically reuse all of it. There's very little furniture that we will need to purchase. The furniture budget will be going from a 6-figure number down to probably less than 10,000.
That's great.
That's wonderful. That's really good news. Huge
savings. And you know, Howard and Marty in particular have worked really hard to identify and quantify and itemize the furniture that's there in the building now and make use of it. So that work that they've done has saved a significant amount of money already.
We'll probably need an inventory of the furniture. You know, just as we broke out the land, we'll probably have to break out the furniture that we purchased because that'll depreciate at a different rate than the building.
Absolutely, yes. So the furniture will, that's a good point. So we'll do that. We'll break that out, the furniture that we end up using. We didn't purchase, but we end up using. I guess that comes off the total cost of the project, right, Liz?
Right.
Okay, so we'll have 3 categories. We'll have land, building, and FF&E. And the FF&E will depreciate it. I think it's 5 or 10 years, and the building at 30 years, and the land, whatever. Yeah.
The land doesn't depreciate.
Okay, there you go.
Yeah.
Jeff, won't we be modifying some of the furniture that's there?
Moderately modifying it. Nothing significant. You know, the example is if you remember the building, those built-in wall units can be disassembled into a tall bookshelf or tall bookcase piece, which is separate, and then a couple lower lower bookshelf pieces, and then a flat table. We're going to take those tall bookshelves and use those. We're going to put them all together and use those for, I think, in which room do they go in, Ivy? Do you remember which room they go in? I believe it's the workroom, one of the workrooms.
Yeah. I think in May's workspace.
That's good news. That's a value add in the purchase of the property. That's
absolutely really, it's a value add.
And really great.
And then the other thing, just Liz, we may also need to break out the solar panels separately too. They probably need a different level too. So we need to know the age of them and what they'll depreciate through too. So I think that's 4 classes of depreciation we need to work about. We need to work on. You know, the solar panels themselves are 6 figures. So all of those things together are massive value add that we got for our building, the cost of the building. And I don't know. Yeah, I think that's it. So you're correct. We need to depreciate those separately. There will be some furniture that we do not keep. We're looking at selling those at a yard sale, essentially. That money will then, I guess, be donated back to the capital fund. We'll go to the capital fund. We also are looking for volunteers to help go to the building and help take apart the furniture. We want to take it into pieces so that it gets stored more efficiently than storing a big table. We want to break it down to its individual pieces and store them that way. So I'm looking for volunteers sometime probably mid-September, late September. We'll have a weekend where we'll just go out and break down the furniture.
Well, that's something, that's a good thing for the notes to the community too.
Yeah, yeah. I was just gonna say that, exactly. Can we put a call out to builders and handymen throughout the village?
Yeah. And even probably or just town. Able-bodied people who can, under supervision, right, Jeff?
Absolutely, and just as a benchmark, I took out the built-ins on one room. It took me 2 hours, and all I needed was a screw gun, essentially. So it's doable by a layman such as me.
I'm sorry, this reminds me of something I didn't put in the agenda, and I should have. I mentioned these storage containers that we want to get to put on site. The board needs to approve the purchase of those. I have the invoice that I can show everyone. I don't know if we can we approve it tonight, or do I need to?
Okay. I believe we can. Yeah.
Okay, let me share that. So the story with these, they're the shipping containers that you've probably seen. And the deal is, as JC explained it, is we purchase them, and then it sounds like as long as we don't damage them or alter them, the person selling us to them would be willing to buy them back from us at like 75% of the purchase price when we're done with them. So,
and it ends up the net of that, Ivy, if I recall correctly, ends up being less expensive than renting them month to month.
Right, exactly. Yeah, right? Yeah. So this is for two of them, it would be $11,400. With the expectation that we would be able to recoup some of that at the end of the project.
What's the size of the containers? It just says
HC. No idea.
It's
the tall storage containers.
I think most of them, I think they said they're like standard shipping containers. Did you say that?
Shipping containers.
Yeah. So, and they've already cut the deal, right? JC, and everyone knows that these are what we need, and we need two of them, right?
Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
I'm going to make a motion to approve this invoice. Is there a second? A seconded by Barry. Any other questions? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And to be clear, this comes out of the capital budget. This comes out of the building budget. Yeah.
Okay, and then so the scheduling the date to have volunteers come out is contingent on getting these containers. So it sounds like we can get them pretty quickly now that we have the approval, and then we can schedule that date to have volunteers take everything apart and put them in the containers once we have this.
Okay, I think that's it with the building that I can think of. Any other things, Ivy, that we missed?
No, I think that's all of it.
Okay, great. Moving on to policy, Barry.
All right. So when we met on August 10th, we discussed, the first thing we discussed is the sexual harassment policy, which we approved a couple of years ago. And if you remember, everybody on the board then read through the policy and watched a video. I brought it up for conversation since we have new members on the board and new staff members, that they should all read through the policy and have a chance to sit down and watch the video. This is mandated by the state for us, so it's something that needs to be done. So after that, we worked on two policies. We worked on the petty cash policy and the unattended children's policy. And there were very small changes made. We upped the amount of supplies for children's programs and to $150. I think before it was $100 or $75. I don't remember. And then the other policy, we just added for the child age of 10 or under, we were very specific about the age, And we all also had to come up with a line to if a child if people refuse to abide by the policy, it may cause a child's library access privileges to be suspended in accordance with the patron behavior policy. So those are two simple changes we made on that one, and one simple change on the other one. Any questions? Do I have to make a motion, or is it part of the consent agenda?
It's part of the consent agenda. Yeah. Just to review it. I do have a question, Ivy. Can you look and see if I have a certificate of completion for the sexual harassment? I don't remember doing it for this organization.
I can check. I mean, and I guess I don't know if it's the same for board members. For staff, we have to do it every year. Mm-hmm. Assuming board members have to, then you might have to do a new one. But I can check to see if we have
that. If there is no policy around it, I would suggest the board members do it at least once every term.
Right.
Minimum.
Yeah, I'll look into that.
Yeah.
Steph, I think that's what it is. Actually, is once every term.
Okay.
If I recall, but you know, the brain is failing.
Yeah, and for those of you who you know haven't done it yet because you're newer, I have the link to the video that you have to watch, and there's a short questionnaire you fill out afterward to verify that you saw it. So I can share that with anybody who needs it.
Okay. Moving on to the next item, which is the budget for 2023.
Okay.
Nice work, everyone. 1.9.
Yes, we came in under the magic number.
Right.
This is the real thing to look at, this little yellow rectangle.
So this is the second review of this budget. And if we approve this budget, then it goes to the vote, public vote. Is that correct?
Correct.
Okay. Do I take us through it, Ivy or Liz, or whoever has experience with it? Will I remember that?
Well, yeah. I think.
Oh, go ahead, Liz.
No, you go ahead.
Well, I was just going to say, so, you know, the only difference from the last time we talked about this, we had, you know, there had been some discussion of how much to raise staff salary and how we could do it while staying under the 2% cap. So what we did with this version is we gave the staff a 5% increase across the board. And to accomplish that, we just had to lower the building contracts budget line by $500. So the number for building contracts is still up from last year, but we brought it down a little bit just so that we could, you know, it's only $500 difference to make the 5% for all staff and stay under
2%.
Okay. I have a question. With people like Michael Lemonier leaving, and he was one of the higher paid staff members, as we bring new people in, they're going to be making less money,
mm-hmm.
I would think. I don't know.
Well, not necessarily, because he was in a supervisory position.
Yeah, I mean, I would say, you know, that just happened. And so I would rather go into the year with a budget based on the staffing we had now than assume we're going to bring on new people who are making less money.
Right. But what I think what I'm getting at is that we're going to have a little more leverage or playroom with salary money because of that. With new people coming on, they'll be making a little less.
Right. But the other side of it is, you know, we didn't give ourselves a whole lot of leeway in terms of staffing up for the new building. Like all we did was add half of a part-timer. So I feel like, it might give us some leeway, but I can see that also being quickly eaten up by the demands of the new building.
Ackman.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's going to be a tough budget year, because if we do move in the building in the middle of the year, it changes a lot.
Mm-hmm. I have a question. The 1.98% is the tax levy increase?
Yes.
Okay. And what is the actual budget the total for the budget?
Oh, where does it show that?
It's going to be on the ballot.
On the bottom.
Where did that go?
Okay.
So 684, is that it?
Oh, there you go. Yeah.
689.
Yeah, it looks like
okay. 680. Well, I need to 850.
I'll zoom in a little bit so that's easier to read.
Yeah,
I'm just doing it for the notes. Okay, 689. 839. Okay. Okay, great. Thank you.
And the total, just to be clear, the total budget increase is 0.73%. Is that what I'm seeing correctly?
0.73%? Okay, great.
The tax levy is 1.98, but the total increase is 0.73.
Just, Jeff, when do people start paying, you know, the bond tax on the bond?
They pay that. So the way it works is they will pay it next year's tax budgets and they will get a year and a half that they pay.
So in 2024.
2024, they'll pay the 2023 and the half of 2022.
Okay.
And then that will level out.
And then that will level out. Right.
Okay.
And then
going forward. It's like a little hit in the beginning. Okay.
Well, yes. There's a shortfall that we have to make up.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
And again, that tax money we will not see in our accounts. The town will keep that tax money and pay the bond
directly.
Agency directly. It won't come through us. Be kept in the town's bank accounts and go directly to, because they're servicing the bond on our behalf.
Okay, good.
Okay.
Great.
Okay. Next.
Sorry, did we actually vote on the budget?
Yeah. No, we did not. So, is your motion to approve the 2023 budgets
proposed? I'm back at that.
Okay.
I love these little races to
second. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay.
And I just want to add Liz and Ivy for getting it under 2%.
Yes.
Absolutely.
I think you guys did a great job. I really appreciate it. I don't envy you having to do with the budget next year. It's going to be much more complicated.
Yes.
But thank you for doing this. Okay, so new business. I'd like to have a trustee election discussion. The idea for this discussion is I don't even know who's up for election.
Oh. Caroline and Barry.
Caroline and Barry, okay.
And they've submitted their petitions.
Wonderful. Thank you so much.
But we have to announce if anyone in the public, you know, we have to announce what the deadline is for their getting their petitions in if they want to be on the ballot. And also we need to know, you know, when people have to, you know, when we're going to have ballots available for absentee ballots and all that kind of stuff.
Do we have those dates now when things are going to be available, Ivy?
So the petitions are posted online on our website. So anybody who wants to run for election, they can ask at the library or they can go to woodstock.org, click on 2023 budget and election. And that has the link to the petition that they would need to take out, get 25 signatures and get it back to me by September 6th.
September 6th.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay, well, we got it. We should announce this right away then.
And that's published, right? Is that published?
Yes. Yeah, today's Hudson Valley One and the Daily Freeman.
Okay, yeah. But is it on the homepage of the website maybe or?
I don't know if it's on the homepage. I can put it on there.
Yeah,
it should be.
With the link, you know, the link to download it. And then do you know when, I guess we'll just announce when we'll announce when absentee ballots are available at the library. They'll be the library is doing this, not the Board of Elections.
Right. Correct. We're not paying the Board
of Elections. We have to print up the ballots.
Yes.
Yes.
And then people will get absentee ballots at the library.
I think there are already there's already a list of absentee. I get mine in the mail.
Yeah, but that's the Board of Elections. That's the Board of Elections.
Right. I got mine in the mail from the library last time.
Yeah.
There's a list. So Heidi has to do is find the list and make sure that those go.
Right. But there may be other people. There may be other people who just are not going to be in town that day.
Let me just clarify. Okay. The Board of Elections has a permanent list of those people who get absentee ballots. And they have a list of those people who get absentee ballots on certain dates. We will get the Board of Elections list of people who get absentee ballots, and we'll send them to those people. As the Board of Elections receives new absentee ballot requests, they should forward that to us, and we'll forward and we'll send absentee ballots, or they can contact us directly for an absentee ballot after that time.
Right, but also people can come in, like when I've been on vacation the week of the library election, you can come in and
vote in person and have a witness.
You know, it gets put in a sealed ballot box.
Absentee ballots can always be picked up at the library, and you can vote at the library in person early.
Okay, so if September 6th is the deadline for people getting petitions in, what is the deadline for getting for printing the ballots? Or I guess we don't have to get that into the Board of Elections if we're
We print them ourselves. Right. So that would be, we'll print the ballots probably on September 7th after the deadline. And after we've certified the petitions. We need to have 3 days. I think we need to have a number of days available for someone to challenge the petitions.
Really?
Yeah. There needs to be a challenge. I know county rules. I don't know library rules.
I don't think we've ever done that.
But I do believe petitions can be challenged.
All right. So it doesn't hurt to wait 3 days before
if we have time.
Yeah.
But I don't know if we've ever announced to people that they can come in and look at them and challenge them. Don't we need someone just them. What?
They have to foil them to challenge them.
Who checks if the people who signed are registered voters?
Only if they're challenged do we check.
Okay. And the 25 signatures is that's, you know, it was like less during the pandemic, and we're sure that 25. No reduction anymore.
Okay.
It was always
25.
Well, no, but during the pandemic, it was less. It was only like 10 or 12. 18,
no.
Yeah, it was.
It was.
The state reduced
all petition requirements for 2 years.
For 2 years.
Significantly, by 40%.
Yeah.
But that reduction is no longer in effect.
One question, what is the actual date for the trustee election?
October 6th.
Okay.
Thursday, October 6th, noon to 9 p.m. at the library.
Dorothy, I'm sorry.
Sure.
I imagine that the ballots and all of these things, the templates of that already exist.
Oh, sure, sure.
Yeah, okay, just.
Yeah, yeah, and actually.
You can print those on demand, right?
Yeah, we're having a staff meeting tomorrow of the people who have been at the library through past elections to kind of bring me up to speed on all of this. But I did get the request in for the voter list to, the Board of Elections yesterday, and they promptly emailed me back to remind me that it was an election day and they were busy.
Right.
So
I said, call them next week. Right.
If you need help stuffing and mailing and all of that, just put me down on that. I'm happy to. Thank you.
Do we have to discuss? We also have to hire,
we need a board resolution to hire the inspector.
Stan Nitsky and three people sign in. And what kind of voting booth we're using. We've had options in the past of what kind of voting booth is being brought in.
We don't use the voting booth.
We have had options of newer booths or older booths at a cost.
We don't use the booth.
It's all written hand ballots, Barry.
Let's not have a discussion back and forth. Yeah. Let's let Barry talk, and then we'll raise your hand, and we'll call on people instead of just going back and forth. It's a little disruptive. So go ahead, Barry.
All right. There needs to be an approval of hiring Stan Nitzky and three people to sit and take names of people registering to come in and vote. The voting booths in the past, there has been an older booth that we've been able to get for practically nothing with the levers, a curtain and levers. And then there's booths, there's writing them out and putting them into a machine. So we've had the option of both. I think the most recent is putting it into the machine and scanning it. I think that's what's been used most recently.
Okay, that is incorrect, Barry. The last election that we did was people checked off a ballot by hand.
Paper ballot, yeah.
Behind a screen, and it was counted by hand. There were no machines involved.
All right. The ones at the library, yes. The only time we did the other thing was for the, for the bond and the, you know. So I just wonder, I mean, someone needs to check if Stan Nitzky is still available and able to do it. And, you know.
I spoke to him at the library fair.
Okay, well.
Sorry, I spoke to him. Yeah, we didn't have I don't think we talked specifically about the election, but I can follow up with him.
And we need to find, we need to find people who are able to do this.
Yes, yes.
You know, I think that we have aged some people out that have done this in the past. Yes. And I think we need to understand that we have aged some people out that have done this in the past.
Yes.
And we need to find younger people. And it's not about the age, it's about,
Ivy, I can email you the names of some younger people I know who are doing this for other elections.
Yeah.
So we don't have to have this vote on approving specific people at this meeting. We can do that at
do it in September.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Anything else on the election? Marsha, I want to make sure that you got everything you need for the minutes, and clearly for the minutes of the. Because this will be something that is, you know, got legal implications if we screw it up. So,
I just want to ask a question. When is the vote for the budget? What's the date for the?
The same, October 6th. The budget vote and the trustee vote is the same day.
Okay.
And it's in our bylaws. You know, it takes place at the library from noon to 9 p.m. Okay. And it's both the trustee, you vote yes or no on the budget, and you vote for, you know, you have the option of voting for up to two trustees.
Okay, very good.
There might be more than two people running, there, you know, may not be.
There's also an option of a write-in. If somebody wants to write somebody's name in the ballot, they can.
Yeah. Recent elections have not been challenged because I think they saw that was not the way to get things changed.
We'll see how it goes this year.
Yeah.
I wouldn't put it past Dan Rubenstein to want to run.
Mm. All right, we're in a public meeting here.
Okay, so any other questions about the election? Are we all clear on everything?
Yeah.
Yes, thank you.
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
Cool. Okay, discussion of how to handle invoices for 1016 Ave, the repurposing project. The example is the storage units that we just, you know, we had to wait to approve that for this meeting. It kind of set the back, you know, we wanted to do this 2 weeks ago. We knew we wanted to do this. So we need to have, or I'm not, we don't need to have, I'm suggesting that we have a process that allows approval of these things without a board meeting with review by the board. So in other words, something where, for example, Ivy and I, if we both agree on a particular invoice, we can sign it, we can authorize the payment, we can bring it back to the board for further authorization. That's a suggestion. I'm up for discussion on how to do this, because having to wait a month between each ability to create a payment will delay the project. Liz.
I suggest that we do two things. One is come up with an amount by which you and Ivy can approve, and we don't need to review it before the board reviews it. And then secondly, eventually we will have contracts with people. And if the board has approved the contract, then I think it's perfectly proper for you and Ivy, or Howard and Ivy, somebody who knows what's going on with the building, to approve it before the board reviews it.
I think that's appropriate. What value are people comfortable with? I'm thinking 20,000, but I'm not sure if that's too high for people's.
I was thinking 25,000.
Okay.
But I don't know, Liz, you have a better experience.
I would say to keep it under 25, there's something about 25 that it's illegal, and I'm not sure what it is, but so 20, I would.
20, okay.
20. I would go with.
Okay, so to be clear, what we're proposing is that between board meetings, a combination of two people, that includes Howard, myself, and Ivy, so any of those two people, can approve a total of $20,000, which will then be brought to the board for final authorization. Okay, so it's not like we can do five examples of 19,000. We get a total of 20,000, period.
That's great.
Okay. Oh, good, good.
I mean, it's smart to have that, because you can't be slowed down over a $5,000 storage container.
Right.
So that's my motion. Do you need it in more English, Marcia, or can you Englishify it?
I'll English it for you.
I'd like to second that then.
Second the motion or the Englishing?
The motion for the thing. The motion for the $20,000 expenditures.
Okay, is there discussion? So there's been motioned and seconded. Is there discussion?
I have a question about how it would work. So we're saying this is like approving new invoices or new contracts, because like JC, he has an existing contract that gets paid, you know, $4,000 right. every month, but that's not counting against the 20,000.
No, because that's the contract the board has approved.
Right, right. Okay.
The board has approved that expenditure. So just need the approval of you and Jeff, for you and Howard.
This would be for new expenditures.
Right, exactly.
Right, right.
Something comes up and you need it. If you wait a month, you're going to set the project off by 2 weeks or so.
Yeah.
Something like the storage container invoice.
Mm-hmm.
Right, that's a good example. Yeah.
And Ivy, you have the discretion to do things for up to 5,000 as direct, right. Correct?
Yeah.
Yeah.
If is the 20,000 total, is that enough? I mean,
I think it probably is. You know, if there's a bill for more than that, we can negotiate with the vendor to do the initial down payment and then put the rest on for the board to approve, for example.
Yeah.
And this is pertaining only to the bond fund.
It's only the bond.
Yeah. Only to the bond fund.
And
only
also
the bond, Marcia.
And Jeff, I guess you could always, you know, come back to the board if you needed to revise that. We could always pass a new resolution if that's not working.
Yeah.
Right. I assume that most of our big expenditures are going to be contractual with an engineer, a construction firm, or so, you know.
Yeah, I mean, those kinds of expenditures are going to be very contractual, because they need to go through a very, very defined process of, you know, public notice and public, public bids. So any, you know, professionals, we don't need to go to public bids, but non-professional services, we need to go to public bids for anything we do for this project.
Right. And professional services, we generally approve a contract, as we did with JC.
Yeah, exactly. So it's just for those things that come up that are like this, you know, one-off expense of a storage containers, for example.
I have something else under new business.
Okay, we need to vote on this. I don't think we've approved this yet. So all in favor of
Aye.
Englishing on it or just
I'll English it in the minutes.
Okay. Aye.
All in favor of that Englishing.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Thank you.
A quick question. Do we need to have a separate group of people approving these vouchers for the money taken for the bonds, the expenses that are going to come out of the bond?
I think we put that in our, I think that becomes a separate item on the, in this example, you see item 3 in the consent agenda, it's to approve the vouchers out of the bond is part of that. So is that what you're asking?
Yeah, I just was wondering if they have to be two different people approving vouchers, one for the existing budget and one the for the board members.
You mean the monthly approvals? Like
after, monthly approvals, yeah.
I don't think so, because that's really just the final checking it off that like everything looks right. And you can do that just as easily for the bond as you can for anything else, because you're just verifying that the check matches the invoice, basically.
Right.
Yeah. Okay. And right. It's nice to have that varying body of members going through that.
So. Yeah. Yeah.
Right.
Okay. Liz, your hand is up. Mm-hmm. Your hand is up, Liz. Did you have? Oh, is that just?
No, I'm sorry. I didn't hand my hand up.
So, Dorothea, you had another new item.
Well, I wanted to. The mention about the town, just to talk to the board about, I replied by email, but the fact that the town board held the first public hearing last night on changing the zone.
I talked to Bill about this. I want to give you his comments on this, if that's okay.
Sure. That's what I'm asking. Yeah.
Okay. So Bill's process for public hearing and then a resolution is that he leaves the public hearing open as, I forget the exact term, but he leaves it open to the call of the chair, that's the term. At the next meeting, he will close the public hearing formally, the first thing he does, then call for a vote. That's how he's done this. I didn't understand that either, so I called and asked that specific question, and that's how he explained that that's what he does for all public hearings.
So we don't need to, there won't be a second public hearing on the 13th.
It's unlikely to be a second public hearing on the 13th, unlikely. He may allow it, but it's unlikely because, I think the people that said what they're gonna say are gonna say the same things over again.
Right.
So there's really not any new things to be said.
Well, that's good to know, thank you. Yeah. And Jeff and Tim and I spoke and some of the other people spoke also.
Yeah.
About it.
I don't want to get into what was discussed there with the public hearing, because that's town board business. But just to clarify, that's the process.
That's very helpful. Thank you.
Yeah.
I just have one, this isn't an item of business. I just have one other question for, if I announce about, having a volunteer weekend, we don't have the date yet, but would people interested, should they email Ivy or Howard or Jeff or JC or, if you want to think about that,
and talk with JC about that and see what he wants to do, see if he can put that on as part of his contract. If not, it'll be either Howard or Ivy or myself.
Okay.
We'll figure it out. Yeah. So we'll give you an answer shortly.
Okay.
When will notes go out, Dorothea?
Well, it depends. I mean, I can write something, I can get something to Ivy and Jeff tomorrow, but, it's a question if we want to fill in some of these details, and I don't know what IB's schedule is for getting it, printed up and stuff. It should be able to go out by Friday, but we could always do it Monday if we had to. I think sometimes in the summer, like doing something on Monday is a little better, with people going, I don't know if it really matters. I would hope that it would go out by Monday at the latest, but we haven't done one for a while because we didn't really have anything to announce from the last board meeting. I think the important thing is to I mean, actually, because of the trustee thing, having a very short deadline of people, you know, we should probably get that out sooner than later. Mm-hmm. We can always announce the volunteer thing when we have the details on it.
Why don't we just, Ivy, do you mind being the person they contact if they volunteer?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. So the only detail, I'll talk to JC tomorrow and find out how soon we can get those containers so that we can decide on which date to have this.
Yeah. And we can always announce it another time, you know.
Yeah.
But I think we should get the word out as soon as possible. Yeah. And, you know, and Nick is probably, he might be on the planning board meeting now. But, you know, if he can put in whatever he writes up in the paper, if he can put the date in, you know, people don't read public notices necessarily.
Yeah. Right. Okay. Thank you. Any other new business? Okay. Any public fear? There's no public except Nick.
I'd like to make a motion to adjourn.
Okay, so there's a motion to adjourn.
I'll second that.
Seconded by Kevin. Discussion. Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay, let's good night, everyone.
Ivy, call me if you need help with the ballot stuff.
Oh, sure. Yeah, thank you.
Okay, ciao.
Good night.